Right, so maybe we can start. So it's my
Okay.
great pleasure to introduce an old friend, Lorenzo Bertini from the University of Rome, and he will speak on energy increasing solutions to the Boltzmann equation. So thank you, Lorenzo, for accepting.
Thanks you for this kind invitation. It's always a pleasure to give a talk at IMPA, even not so. It would be a much greater pleasure to be in Rio and give the talk in presence, but nonetheless, it's just a poor surrogate for that we get used to, and so I will enjoy it as well. So if you just open the microphone, I will also listen to the monkey outside the IMPA and will recall my days there. Okay, so thanks again for the invitation. So I will report on some work in collaboration with some other people in Rome that are working on kinetic equation. In fact, I carefully avoided the use of the word large deviation in the title, but this is going to be a talk on large deviation and for kinetic models. And so I've been doing large deviation from hydrodynamical scaling limit for like 30 years. And then, so getting in touch with other colleagues, I was involved in this project regarding kinetic model, kinetic equation. And at the beginning, it was I say snob. I was thinking there was no real problem in kinetic model. They were essentially mean field models. So there is nothing really interesting doing that. But it turned out there is some problem. And just to avoid that completely, just let me spoil everything. We are not going to have a full large deviation principle. In fact, there are problems that we are not able to solve. So this, if somebody is looking for some open problem, we will find some open problem about this. So this is okay. So, and also I will restrict completely to homogeneous models. So we'll have only velocities and no space variable and just the style of CATS models. I mean, there have been really good research and stochastic microscopic dynamic. This will be the setting. On these regards, have been really good work by Fridur Razzagalu a few years ago, and he was doing the non-homogeneous case, but he was considering the case of, say, bounded velocity, and the effect I will focus on with really present in the case of unbounded velocity. So these are some kind of different direction of investigation. So it will be the general setting. I will introduce the microscopic dynamic. I explain what is a candidate rate function, then say there is a problem for the candidate rate function, and explain what is the problem, and then I will offer a cure for this problem and a better candidate for the rate function, but the full proof is still missing. Okay, so this is the plan. So let me move on and explain what is this CATS work. It's really mean field model. Like this, you have n variables that for some interpretation we call velocity, V1, Vm, and each Vi is in Rd. And the dynamics, stochastic dynamic, is very simple. At each, there is a Poisson clock. To each edge, it's in the complete graph. Everybody is, there is no spatial structure. So to each couple of velocity, Vi, Vj, there is attached an exponential clock. When it rings, these two velocities, we call velocity, but there is no, I mean, just variables in Rt, they exchange randomly the velocity. So this is the formal generator of the process. So this is Lj. Lij is the process on each pair of velocity, Vij, and the rules are very simple. You add velocity Vi, Vj, and then with some kernel, this is B, you produce new velocity, Vi prime, Vi prime J, which is just required to satisfy the conservation of momentum of energy. So this is a parametrization, V prime and Vi. You can parameterize with a unit vector omega. And once you specify this form, this Vi prime J will satisfy the conservation of momentum and energy. And the kernel which this upgrade, so this collision, this random exchange of velocity happen, will be B, Vi, Vj, and omega. The real form of B will not so important for our kernel, but for the definiteness, we stick to the case of the kernel of hard sphere dynamics. This is, in this case, it's just the B is just the, say, the negative part of the inner product between the difference of the velocity and the omega, which is like the impact impact parameter of the collisions. This is the kernel of art sphere. This specific form for what I'm going to discuss is not very important, but will be very important for the phenomena that I will focus on, that this kernel B is unbounded, that if the relative velocity Vi minus Va is large, then the corresponding rate B becomes very large. This is, if this is not present, the phenomena that I'm going to focus it will not happen. So this is very important, but this is also natural from the physical point of view. The higher the velocity are, the more frequent the collision. So if you are not familiar with this model, so this is purports the name of brings the name of Katz, and it sounds essentially introduced by him as a really top toy model for a Boltzmann equation. But not so toy, we are still working on this. So let's see what it is. This, I scaled the process by this 1/n. So it means the number of pairs are like n squared. Of course, I will be interested in the large n limit of these dynamics. So typically we'll have order n number of collisions, where a collision is just an upgrade between the velocity, but each particle, there are n velocity, each particle will have an order one collision. So this is really the scaling of kinetic equation. And we want to understand what this dynamics does when n is large. And in particular, we want to understand, as I will see, yes, you will see soon, the large number is well known. And we are going to investigate the large deviation of this dynamic in this limit n to infinity that is just the kinetic limit. And so one of the main emphasis of this talk, that to understand the fluctuation about the limit, the correct paradigm to understand the fluctuation is not the Gaussian central limit type paradigm of fluctuation, but for really the nature of kinetic models, the correct paradigm to understand the fluctuation is the Poissonian paradigm, because in time of order one particle have order one collision. There is no central limit Turing going on because the collision will be 3-4. And so the correct paradigm to understand the fluctuation is just the Poisson paradigm, not the Gaussian paradigm. This is really
I have a question, Lorenzo.
Yes, please.
About your integration, I'm not familiar with this. So
sure.
This omega, you integrate over RD or just over the
S1?
The
S1.
On the sphere. Okay.
Omega is a unit vector on the sphere.
Yeah. Okay. So SD minus one. Yes. Okay,
you see that this is the rule. V prime J. Omega is, if an RD in 3D will be the two-dimensional sphere, SD minus one. It's a unit vector.
Okay, thanks.
So this is really, because this is the way it's written, is the collision parameter. This is the way to parameterize the new velocity in terms of the order. If you draw a picture, you understand that. So, which I didn't, I apologize about that. You understand that the omega, the role of this omega. So this integration is in the sphere. Okay, is this clear? So please, any question is welcome, because if, in particular on the basic model, because otherwise there is no understanding. Okay, so what are the objects that we are interested?
Yes. May I ask a question too? Maybe a silly question, because you are saying that the right paradigm here is Poissonian type of large deviations, but you have this continuous integration over the sphere. So I'm a little bit puzzled. How should we think about this?
You have to think that the number of collision per particle is related really by the Poisson point process. It's going to be, if you wait 5 minutes, it will be very clear what I mean by that.
Okay, thank you.
But really, so the randomness is in the collision mechanism, and what is how it happens, the collision is not many, because we are looking per particle. There are not many collisions that make an average and the fluctuation behave Gaussianly. This is the paradigm in the hydrodynamic limit, in which you have many collisions for a macroscopic unit of time. And so there is a central limit theorem effect going on, and we'll see Gaussian fluctuation. Here, the collision will be 3-4 And so the correct paradigm per macroscopic unit of time, and so the paradigm to understand the fluctuation is Poissonian. This will be very clear. Hopefully this will be clear in the next slide. So this is the idea. I mean, Poisson point process, not Poisson random variable. This, by Poisson, I mean Poisson point process. Okay, that's, let's see what are the objects that we are interested in. So traditionally, the main object of interest to take the large n limit is the empirical, okay, I encode empirical density, but is an empirical measure of the velocity, which just the usual empirical measure. So pi n is mapped from the microscopic configuration space, which is rd to the n, to the probability measure on the rd. This is the empirical measure. So after the experience with hydrodynamics, let me also introduce another observable, which records not where the distribution of the velocity, but the distribution of the collision. So what in the context of hydrodynamic limit is the empirical current. Here we are just not taking the net current, but just using the flow, so it's just a positive measure. And let me give the definition. So you look at your path, microscopic path, V of T, and then you want to describe where the collision happens. So you do the following. You fix a small time interval, T plus the T. T is already scaled up, and then you want to count the number of collisions that happen in this time, little time interval, where the incoming velocity, Vi and Vi, Vj, are in some small window, V plus the V star plus the V star, and the outgoing velocity will be in some other small V window, V prime to delta V prime star, V prime star plus delta V prime. So the notation are the one typically in kinetic theory. So V and V star are the incoming velocity, V prime and V prime star are the outgoing velocity. Of course, this measure will be supported only on the set of velocity that satisfy the conservation rules. But I mean, it's simple if you think that as this is a measure in all RD times four times with appropriate support property. Okay, and then I divide by 1/n because the total number of collision will be over the n squared. This is the right scaling. So this is really the empirical flux. You don't recall it gives you this additional information on where the collision happens. And where in time and which were the incoming outgoing velocity of the collision. Okay, and so this is not surprising. There is a pathwise continuity equation. If I tell you the empirical flow and the initial distribution of velocity at time zero, you can reconstruct all your path. And this is the formal way to specify the continuity equation. So you take the expectation of the empirical measure of the derivative of a test function phi, and this is like just the divergence of the flow, but here the divergence is not differential divergence because the change of velocity is finite. So you integrate again this Q. Qn is just a measure on time and the four times the velocity, phi prime star, phi here is a function of a single velocity, and phi prime means phi computed at v prime, phi prime star, phi computed at v prime star, and so on. So these notations are like terrible from a logical point of view, but these are the one used in kinetic equation, and I mean they have some advantages. So one needs to get used to it. So let me tell you what is the law of large number of this pair. This is really almost 60 years of history, started with Katz himself, and usually referred as propagation of chaos result. I mean, here the microscopic dynamics is stochastic, so it's really not much the subtlety of Newtonian dynamics. So assume at time zero, the empirical measure tends to some probability, which is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue and denoted by F naught the density. Then at time t, Assigned to infinity, this the empirical measure will converge still to absolute continuous measure. The density will have t. The measure qn, which is a measure on times, time velocity for times, is for each n, it is really a point mass, this atomic measure, but in the limit will converge to some absolutely continuous measure, both with respect to the t, v and v star, which are the incoming velocity, and the omega, which is the impact parameter, and b is just the kernel, and then I have the density of the incoming velocity at ft, at time t at v, and the density of the at the other velocity v star. So this means that incoming velocity v and v star are sampled independently from the limit of pi naught. This is usually referred at the propagation of chaos. In particular, if you take out the empirical flow q and you see that the continuity equation here passed the limit trivially because it's linear in pi and q, and this is the content, you will see that f is a closed evolution, which is a homogeneous Boltzmann equation. This is the homogeneous Boltzmann equation with this kernel v. So you want to know the evolution of the density f. I mean, you compute f at v. You now take another particle, you distribute at v star, and then you integrate all the other incoming velocity v star. Then you have to put the density of probability of having a particle in v, the other in v star, which is this one, and then you put the density of outgoing velocity, and then you put the relevant. So this is just the homogeneous Boltzmann equation in this context. And this theorem is essentially, Katz was the first to prove it, and there have been improvement, but this part of history is too long, so I will not discuss. And so what is our aim is to understand the fluctuation with respect to this law of large number, but the fluctuation in the sense of large deviation. And so what will be relevant for this future is the fact, the role of energy conservation, because the macroscopic dynamics conserve the energy exactly, but we'll see that something may happen at the macroscopic level after the limit, and we want really to understand what is the role of the microscopic conservation of the energy with respect to the macroscopic.
So, Lorenzo?
So, and yes, please.
Yeah. So do you have any issue with the uniqueness of this equation or, yeah, or is
we will arrive. Let's okay. See. Okay, this will be a central part of this the topic. This was really important. So this is specially homogeneous, so there is uniqueness of this equation in some class. It's not a non-homogeneous Boltzmann equation, you know, this is so a millennium problem, but this is homogeneous, and there is uniqueness in some class and some other phase, and the fact that phase will be relevant for this talk. This question is really central to this talk. Okay. But we will have to wait.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Okay. So let's say what is okay. First, a triviality. Let me recall what is the large deviation principle for a Poisson point process. So let's take Q, a Poisson point process with on some space that here in this picture is R2, but it's just anything with the intensity measure little q. So this, so I assume that everybody knows what is a Poisson point process. So it's just an atomic measure. You count the number of particles in some volume, bounded volume V. This is just a Poisson random variable with the integral of the kernel. And then if you have two disjoint sets, this random variable is independent. This defines a Poisson point process. Now we just say speed up the intensity by factor n. Little q with this intensity goes to nq. And corresponding the process goes to Qn, and we want to understand the large deviation of this family when n gets large. The answer is very simple. This is the usual large deviation principle, as an upper bound on closed and open set. The topology is which the one induced by convergence with convergence the measure. And the rate function of Q is essentially the entropy, the relative entropy of the measure Q with respect to the intensity measure dq. But these are not probability measures, so there is this extra term which account from the difference of the mass. E of Q is just the entropy of the measure Q with respect to the little q, And this term is just a difference of the mass. This is just the rate function of a Poisson point process. And this is very easy to deduce. So here, the intensity is very large, so n. So typically, at the large deviation level, we'll see this q, which will be only absolutely continuous with respect to the intensity measure q. Okay. So having recalled that, let me tell what is the candidate rate function for our kinetic problem. This is candidate, and will be candidate up to the end of the talk, but will be an improved candidate afterward for some problem that I'll explain. So before looking at the picture, let me tell you the picture. You have this collision which happened with the empirical flow, Qn records the collision in time and the distribution of the process. So you have to think that this process behaves, as far as the large deviation are concerned, as a Poisson point process. So the large deviation will be like the collision at random with a Poisson rule, but you have to know the intensity. What is the intensity of this Poisson process, which tells you where the collision happened, where both in time and which are the incoming and outgoing velocity? This is just the intensity that you compute from the homogeneous Boltzmann equation. So you need also the pi, which is the limit of the empirical measure. So this will be the typical behavior of the flow. You pick two V and V star independently with tau, and then this will go to velocity V prime with kernel V dio. So this is just the large deviation, or is like the large deviation principle, rate function for a Poisson process Q with intensity pi times p. But now pi and Q have a link because they have the continuity equation. So this is not, the particles do interact, but they interact in the sense only even at the level of just deviation that the intensity is not given a priori, but you have to deduce from the flow in terms of the continuity equation. So this is the candidate rate function. So this is should explain. Of course, I'm going to say that this rate function is a little wrong, but just a little wrong. So this formula should make clear why I say that the correct paradigm to understand fluctuation is Poisson paradigm, because this is just the rate function of a Poisson point process. But the intensity is not given a priori, but determined by the continuity equation. Of course, this is just the dynamical part. Then there is a term which regards the fluctuation at time zero. At time zero, we are not really starting with a deterministic initial data, but really with a distribution of velocity recorded by F naught, and we also require F naught to be absolutely continuous. So we see how I will say later how really we pick the distribution of the initial distribution, but certainly there is a contribution of the large deviation due to the fluctuation of the initial data, and this is just, it depends only on the empirical density at time zero. And so in the candidate, age of pi zero is just the relative entropy of pi zero with respect to reference measure. So this is the candidate function for this problem. And in fact, okay, this has been proven long ago by Leonard. So not so long ago, say 90s. No, in his formulation, there were no empirical flow, but this is just a matter of presentation. It makes no difference. It just makes more, to me, it makes the rate function much more readable if you write it in the per empirical density, empirical flow, as in the case of aerodynamics. But as far as the proof is concerned, it's really a little modification adding the flow. This rate function has been deduced. The first that I know is Leonard. He proves only the upper bound without Q. Then there was also some recent progress, also work by, as I said before, by Fedor Zakharlou and other people. And so maybe, I guess all of you have been know of this very recent work by the French group. We did something in this direction for Newtonian dynamics, so non-homogeneous, and this is really fantastic results. And apart from the fact that it's not spatially homogeneous and the dynamics deterministic, the rate function they obtain is similar to this one. It's not exactly, this is homogeneous, but it's really in the same speed. Okay, let me point out that this rate, I mean, let me point out, following Heidegger, which is just pointed out that this was the first time, that this candidate rate function has a serious problem, and in some sense it cannot be right, in the sense that its zero-level set is not the correct one. It does not produce the right law of large number. So let me explain why this is so and what happens. And this is exactly related to the question of the uniqueness of the equation to the homogeneous Boltzmann equation. Okay. So what is now, I come back to the statement of uniqueness. So there is really a classical result that there is unique solution if F conserves the energy. Energy for me is the integral of V square, V square over two. If you have a path Ft for which the energy is conserved, then, and solve this equation, then there is a unique solution. But if the path F does not conserve the energy, there are other solutions. Let me explain what are these solutions, how they are constructed, and why they become relevant for the large deviation state. In fact, with this other solution, we'll have zero candidate rate function, but this other solution do not appear as law of large number. This theorem of Katz and other people says that the pi naught converges to F. F is the unique solution of the homogeneous Boltzmann equation that conserves the energy. There is this fail of uniqueness, it does not affect of the law of large number, but it will affect the large deviation principle. I mean, and this no uniqueness happens because the kernel B is unbounded. Otherwise, the story is different, but I'll focus on this story. Okay, let me say, so this is no probability at all. It's just how to construct solution of this equation, which do not conserve the energy, and more precisely, for which the energy is increases. So this construction is due to Lu and Bember. There is no probability at all. We just, okay. So let me say again, we are going to construct a weak solution to the homogeneous Boltzmann equation, which do not conserve the energy. And in fact, the energy will increase. I mean, the energy at time t will be strictly larger than the energy at time zero. This seems quite strange because microscopic model, the energy maybe can decrease, but because going to infinity, but cannot really increase. But so the right paradigm, in fact, that will this solution will increase the energy just because we are at time zero, we are going to send some part of the energy to infinity. So let me explain how it's done. Pick a parameter epsilon that will go to zero, then consider the energy conserving solution of the Boltzmann equation, which this initial data, which is like the mass 1 minus epsilon is F naught, it stays at finite, like this picture. And then you put a little mass, epsilon, so it will not affect the weak limit, very far. I mean, this is picture, very far, in so V in RD, so very far, but in order to keep the, say, zero momentum. Little mass epsilon to infinity, but this mass that goes to infinity will, as epsilon goes to zero, will carry a finite fraction of the energy. So you start this homogeneous Boltzmann equation with this initial datum, and there is a unique solution. You evolve at time t, and this for each epsilon will have the same energy of this one because this is conserving. But when you send epsilon to zero, what will happen that at positive time, some fraction of the energy that at time zero, no, all the energy that at time zero you are sending to zero with G epsilon will get back to finite. This is because the kernel is diverging for high velocity. So if V are very large, the collision rate is very large. And so when collision happens, will bring the energy back to zero. But this, so again, at time zero, you send some part, a fraction of the energy to infinity. But for finite time, this energy will be gotten back to compact. So actually, you will see the F naught epsilon converge to F naught, which has energy strictly less than one. Say that for each epsilon, this energy of epsilon 1, 1. But at time zero, you see energy 1. But at time zero, you see energy strictly less than one because you send something to infinity. So the plot of the energy is like this. We'll have a discontinuity at time zero. Because you send some energy at infinity at time zero, but by the regularizing property of this equation, this fraction get back to finite infinite. So this is they are constructed. In fact, there is nothing special about zero. This construction you can do at any time, and you construct even piecewise constant increasing energy profile of the energy. If it's not piecewise constant, it is more delicate and will not enter in this Okay, this is how to me. This is just a solution of the equation, and so the basic question we are asking now is how this solution, what is the probability? Now we have a microscopic model and we want to discover the probability of this solution if at the level of large deviation. If we take the candidate function, we plug it here and we see that this is zero because these are a weak solution. So the J along this solution, you take the flow, the empirical flow, the corresponding one, the typical one, and then we'll have zero dynamical rate function. And so there is, okay. Maybe it's true, this rate function, but there is some problem. Is zero level set are not just the law of large number, it is larger. So may happen a few things. I mean, you can see this, what is the scale in which you see this other equation, let's say Luhn-Bamberg solution, energy increase solution. One may think that these are very improbable. So to the scale E minus N, we don't see, they do not happen. Or one may think they are not so improbable. You really need something polynomial or sub-exponential in N to distinguish between this solution and the typical solution. But the fact this solution, the probability of this solution, asymptotic probability of observing this solution in the large deviation sense from a microscopic stochastic dynamics will be on the same order of the other large deviations, so will be over the E minus N. In fact, this E minus N is the correct rate of the solution that has been actually proven by Heidegger. But so our improvement, we are going to discuss the exact rate. And we also produce a better candidate for rate function. This is our improvement, but Heidegger has actually shown that this, the scale of large deviation of this solution is really over E minus N as the other large deviation. Yeah. So, let's see how to prove the large deviation principle. The upper bound is, I think, is somehow technical, is not really so relevant for this course. I want really to discuss the probability of this solution. And so we have to understand how to create this picture in which you send some fraction of the energy to infinity at time zero from our stochastic model with n velocity. So this is the first thing that we want to discover, to find the asymptotic. And really the mechanism for creating this solution is purely static. The dynamics, you just solve the typical behavior, you just solve the homogeneous Boltzmann equation with conserving energy, but just you want to send some fraction of the energy at infinity at time zero. And so we want to know what is the probability of doing that. Of course, this probability is going to be exponentially small, but we want to. So this is just a purely static problem, and it's just son of theorem, but not for ID random variable, but for some microcanonical constraint. Let me explain more precisely. What I mean by this, take n random variable, V1, Vn, ID with some loop, M. Okay, so you can think that M is the Gaussian or as Gaussian tail. This will be important, but Gaussian tail, this is important. You want to do large deviation of the empirical density. So this is large deviation principle or not large number. Of course, this is a mistake. This is Sano, and there is really basic on large deviation, saying that this family satisfies a large deviation principle with some rate function that I call canonical, because here I'm taking n velocity, vn, vn, id, so without constraint at all, just n. So this in the statistical mechanics terminology is just canonical ensemble of velocity. And the rate function is just the relative entropy of pi with respect to the reference measure M for which you sampled. This is standard mean sum of theorem. But now we want to understand what happens where this B, B1, Bn are not ED, but just ID conditional on the total energy. So I take M power N is the product measure of this B, and then I condition this measure on the fact that total energy per particle is small e. So I take this product measure, I condition on the fact that the total energy per particle is fixed and equal little e. Also, I will have to fix on the momenta u in the application, but the momenta are not relevant for this discussion. So if you forget, it's better. Now, we want to understand large deviation of the empirical density with respect to this constraint measure, say microcanonical measure in the statistical mechanical terminology. So what happens? Of course, this measure gives zero support to energy of pi n strictly larger than e. So there is no way you can produce probability larger than e. This explains this plus infinity otherwise. On the other hand, for n finite, this pi n, the energy of pi n, is exactly equal to little e. But this constraint will not stay in the limit as n to infinity. In fact, I mean, if you want to, if you think about weak topology, if you take the set of all probability on RB with the constraint the energy is fixed and equal to little e, and you take the weak closure of this set, you get all the probabilities was total energy was energy with second moment, let's say, is strictly less than. So in order to be semi-continuous, this functional cannot be plus infinity if the energy is strictly less than e. In fact, it's something else. This is just the entropy canonical, so the canonical rate function, the relative entropy of pi respect of m, and plus you have an additional cost if you want to see less energy than e. E is the constraint. If you see less energy, let's say pi by square over 2, you pay an additional cost for this sum constant c. So this is the statement of the Sanoff theorem for the microcanonical example. So if M is Gaussian, this has been done by somebody else before, but in the general case of M, this is something we did. I don't know if somebody else did it before, because it seems a very classical problem. But I mean, we found this only for M Gaussian. So this will tell us what is the cost for producing this energy increasing solution. Let me say, okay, now we are going to have a theorem which say the large deviation upper bound for unimproved rate function, not the candidate above, that is this problem that is zero with respect to this energy increasing solution, but will be strictly positive of this energy increasing solution. Okay, I think that the initial distribution of the particle will be microcanonical. So I take as initial distribution of the n particle, as m is a reference measure, take the product measure, and then I condition on the total energy and the momentum. But the momentum, since the energy is conserved, the energy is quadratic, the momentum is linear, this constraint will be kept in the limit n to infinity. The energy, because this is the constraint that pi, if the second moment of the measure is bounded by one, the first moment is compact. This is the statement. Now we take the Pn with this initial condition, the law of Cotes-Work, starting with this microcanonical ensemble. Of course, here we cannot take me. If you take here M, the Gaussian will be, the process will be stationary, because the Gaussian conditional to the energy is just a uniform measure, which is just the invariant measure of the uniform dynamics. So in order to see non-trivial dynamics, we cannot take M Gaussian. So if M is Gaussian, this is just the stationary process. Okay, so this is the usual statement of the large deviation principle for the pair, empirical measure, empirical flows. So this is upper bound. So the infimum, the probability of a closed set is just I, which depends on E and U, which is parameter of my model of the initial datum, if you want. And this is at time zero, I have H E U of pi zero, which is the microcanonical version of Sanoff theorem. So it's the relative entropy plus the microcanonical constraint. This one, I mean, the one that I have here, apart from the fact that there is the extra constraint of the momenta, mu, and not only of the energy. So the initial data. And then there is the dynamical part. The dynamical part will be the one as before, this is crossed, but there is a constraint. The constraint is that the momenta of pi needs to be u at any time. This is conserved, and the energy needs to be less or equal than e, because the initial dynamics conserve as this exactly equal to e. And so if I take limit points, the strict equality will become an inequality. So it's taking limit. This is what happens, as I explained before. And now, for really this constraint says that if I plug here a Luhmann-Weinberg solution, this does not satisfy. I will pay something here from the initial data. The dynamical cost will be zero. But if I want, this is really the energy at time zero. So if I plug for pi a solution to a Liebermann, this rate function will be strictly positive. This is this. Okay, let me say just two words, how to prove this theorem. You just construct exponential martingales, you perturb the rate, you have the original rate, you do a perturbation, you change the rate with some exponential, you compute the Radon-Nikodym derivative, and you do minimax. Okay. If somebody knows how standard large deviation methods has no problem in doing that, for the others, I mean, it's not this is not the right place to learn it, but just to construction of some exponential martingale, and that's will do the job for this upper bound. I mean, these are a kinetic model. So there is no one and two block as in the hydrodynamics. Essentially, the equation is already closed. You have only to, the only error comes from the fact that in this product, there is the diagonal counts where a microscopic is not counting. It's just essentially nothing. And skip. And let me tell what happens for the lower bound. Lower bound, there is a problem because, and up to now, I mean, the lower bound happens only for a restricted class of Q in particular, and we require that Q has finite second moment. If this holds, there is a lower bound which match the upper bound. But if does not, we don't know. I don't say any word about this lower bound because it's quite technically. But I want to see some improvement with respect to this statement that for really Luhmann-Weinberg solution, which do not satisfy the constraint because the energy with the flux of V square will not bounded for a Luhmann-Weinberg solution, you can in fact have a matching lower bound to the upper bound. Okay, let's see what is the class of Luhmann-Weinberg solution we are considering. This some energy profile, piecewise constant, like in this picture. And then there exists by the procedure I said before, just time zero, I said, but you do at any time, there exists a Luhmann-Weinberg solution for which the energy is this profile that you fixed, this f of t. Then, okay, so this is the theorem. Fix, well, this I cannot say. Fix an energy profile E. Then there exists how many Luhmann-Weinberg solutions there are. This is the difficult question, and we don't know. We cannot characterize all of them. But there exists one which we obtain by a limiting procedure, exactly the one I described before for a single time, for which the lower bound matches the upper bound. So this I is the I of the upper bound. So for any open set of this Luhmann-Weinberg solution with the corresponding flow, which is just a typical one, solution of the homogeneous Boltzmann equation, the lower bound on this open set, this A is equal to this A, matches the upper bound. Okay, how is done? This, so it's saying for this Luhenberger solution that will be constructed as a limit of energy conserving solution, the upper bound matches the lower bound. So how is done? The proof of this step. Okay, this is said before, you realize F at the limit of energy conserving path, as we discovered before. Now, I mean, just by the diagonal procedure, for F epsilon for this path, we know the lower bound because this F epsilon will fit in the class here because this is energy conserving. And now we take epsilon to zero after N, in a sense, proving the passing to the limit to the rate function. If you want, let's see how to produce F epsilon as a deviation from the Katz work. Recall, what is F epsilon? It's like all the one minus eps of the mass is typical behavior. And then epsilon the mass goes to infinity, but let's say that not at time zero, but we want to send it to infinity at some time, t star. So, so what we do? There are two kinds of particles. Red particles are normal, and they are, say, a fraction one of the particle is red. Then there are blue particles, which is right, sorry, a fraction one minus epsilon of the particle is red. Then there is a fraction epsilon of the particle, which are blue. And the blue particle are just do nothing up to t star. They, sorry, do nothing means they do not move. They stay still. And then we send the energy of the blue particle to infinity at this time t star with this procedure. So in this way, for any epsilon, we produce an energy conserving solution. And then so for epsilon finite, this is the correct rate function. This rate function is not zero because F epsilon does not solve for epsilon finite the homogeneous Boltzmann equation because there is a fraction epsilon of the particle which do not move. But as epsilon goes to zero, this fraction goes to zero, and this part will go to the rate function equal to the upper bound. And this, according to the constraint, for the microcanonical constraint, will be exactly the one of the upper bound. Okay? Let me say very briefly what happened for the canonical ensemble. Okay. Because maybe, so the original work by Heidegger was working canonical, non-microcanonical ensemble. So we want to understand same problem, but we do not constraint of the energy at time t. In fact, we start with a product measure. So there is some abstract Large Deviation Lemma. It says the following. Take a sequence of measure, mi n, and assume that b is a. They can be disintegrated with respect to ni n. So we want to represent canonical measure as a superposition on the energy of microcanonical measure. So we want to deduce the Large Deviation Principle with canonical data from the one from microcanonical. So this is the interpretation of this decomposition. Ni n, e is just the product measure given the energy, and this is the mixing measure. Assume that this ni and e does a Large Deviation in some rate function fe uniformly, and this pi n, which is the mixture, does a Large Deviation in some rate a, then you get a Large Deviation principle for mi n, which the easy to guess rate, which is inf over e of I of e, which is this one, plus f of e of x, which is a rate of this. So with this technology, this is, we can deduce the Large Deviation principle from with canonical and initial data. If you do just at the level of Sano with no dynamics, so this is microcanonical of e is the Large Deviation of Sano with microcanonical, the one I explained before, this one with this constraint of the energy, this one plus infinity, and this e of e is just the rate function of how it's called, Large Deviation of Random Vectors, the Cramer's theory. Then if you do the info over A, you reproduce the canonical rate function. This is an application of this theorem, but you know already, which is just a relative entropy. But now, when we do dynamically, there is an additional constraint. Now, we write the same decomposition, but from the law of the Katz work, in which we just take the mixture of the initial datum. So by this abstract lemma and the rate function, the large deviation principle for this, we deduce the large deviation with canonical initial data with this rate function. A, E is just the Cramer's large deviation because this M is product. Here is the rate function of this microcanonical Katz work. This is the rate function. But if this, there is a constraint here, E, that the energy of pi at each time needs to be less than E. If you drop this constraint, then the infimum over E acts only on the first two, and you reproduce the candidate rate function for the canonical, the relative entropy plus the dynamical part. But I mean, you have to recall that this constraint, exactly this constraint, forbids for having Luhmann-Bamberg solution rate functions. So in fact, I mean, this the zero level set of this functional is exactly the law of large number. There is absolutely. So maybe I was 5 minutes too long, but then I apologize, and this ends.
Well, thank you very much, Lorenzo. So questions?
I have a question.
Okay, Paolo, please. No, go ahead.
Lorenzo, if you take, instead of your interchange of velocities when they interchange, you take just a one-dimensional KMP, your theorem holds is in that case?
In this case, there is no this effect of Luhmann-Bamberg because the rates are bounded. But you can construct something with the energy increasing. We have done something exactly in this direction that you say. But in this case, if you take, we have really done this. So you're saying that the energy are discrete and this, but no, this can be on the complete graph. No spatial fraction.
The complete graph, you interact with everybody, but you have a finite number of interactions.
Yes, exactly. This model we considered. And for this model, you can construct, I mean, there is a unique weak solution. So there is this effect of Luhmann-Bamberg is not there. But you can see at the large deviation paths which increase the energy. And, with probability E minus N, you can construct a path which finite rate function, which the energy increases. So even it doesn't pay zero, but you can violate the conservation of the energy for the same mechanism that I explained here.
Okay, thank you.
So we have discussed this.
So I have a question. Could you consider this problem? So you fix an energy evolution, and now you take K particles. Can you prove a law of large numbers for these K particles conditioned on the evolution of the energy of the global system?
Should it recast it as a minimum problem of this rate function?
Yeah, it's more or less a minimum problem of this rate function. You're saying that there exists one which has a positive weight. Well, that doesn't exclude that there is one which is zero rate. So maybe that one...
No, because you see, this is... there is no theory that characterizes all the solution, all the weak solution. These are constructed just by sequential limit of energy conserving solution. we cannot exclude there are some which is not constructed in this way, or if it's constructed, I mean, if you approach this limit from another direction, maybe the rate is not the one that we compute. So for what I discussed, for you are not happy, so.
No, but that conditional, if you could prove that conditional limit, it would give you the one with minimal cost.
Sure, but it, yeah, okay. But my proof of proof, so my route to prove the conditional limit will be appealing to large deviation principle. Yeah, I agree. So, sure. I see what you mean, but I don't see really well. Yeah, maybe. Okay. So I see what you mean.
Well, in any case,
maybe it's not okay. I see. I don't know.
Hubert has a question also.
Yeah, no. It was to be sure to understand. Can you exclude? Can you prove that having a non-constant energy profile, having an increasing energy profile, has exponential cost or not?
Yes, we know that the zero level set of the upper bound we proved, and the rate function of the upper bound, the zero level set is the singleton, which is the energy conserving solution of Leuenberg.
Okay.
So as far for the upper bound, the answer is yes. For a matching lower bound, we can do only if this solution, say, is producing according to this limiting procedure.
Okay, thank you.
If it's produced another way, I don't know, because, in particular, the large deviation upper bound with the improved rate function will imply a low large number with exponential error. This we do.
Thank you.
Okay, welcome.
Any other question? Well, if not, let's thank Lorenzo again for this very nice talk.
Okay, it was my pleasure. So how are the monkeys, the birds? Show me a window. So show me.
Lorenzo, I invited you so many times. So it's just let me know when you want to come.
I told you. I will.
Pleasure. Okay, so we're waiting for you.
My pleasure, of course.
Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye. Thanks again.